In this lesson, we will derive the equation for the hydrostatic pressure gradient. Imagine a small fluid element of mass dm, constant density rho, and dimensions dx, dy, and dz. This element is part of a fluid where no shearing stresses exist, that is, fluid elements are not sliding against each other. The small fluid element would experience a small gravitational force, dFg, and small pressure forces on each of the six faces. The pressure forces in the y direction are labeled dF1 and dF2. The pressure forces in the z direction are labeled dF3 and dF4, and the pressure forces in the x direction are labeled dF5 and dF6. Applying Newton's second law in the x direction, dF6 minus dF5 equals the mass of the fluid element, dm, times the acceleration of the fluid element in the x direction, ax. If we label the center of the fluid element as some point in space, xyz, then both dF5 and dF6 act at a distance 1/2 dx away from the center. dF5 acts at a point x plus 1/2 dx, yz, and dF6 acts at point x minus 1/2 dx, yz. Recalling that pressure is force per area, we can rewrite the pressure force dF5 as the pressure at point x plus 1/2 dx, yz, times the area dy dz. The pressure force dF6 is the pressure at point x minus 1/2 dx, yz, times the area dy dz. The mass of the fluid element dm is equal to the density of the fluid element rho times the volume of the fluid element dx dy dz. Now we substitute the expressions for dF5, dF6, and dm into the equation of motion in the x direction. Applying Newton's second law in the y direction, we see that dF2 minus dF1 equals the mass dm times the acceleration in the y direction, ay. Both dF1 and dF2 act at a distance 1/2 dy away from the center. So dF1 acts at point x, y plus 1/2 dy, z, and dF2 acts at point x, y minus 1/2 dy, z. We can rewrite the pressure force, dF1, as the pressure at point x, y plus 1/2 dy, z, times the area dx, dz. And the pressure force, dF2, is the pressure at point x, y minus 1/2 dy, z, times the area dx, dz. And now we substitute the expressions for dF1, dF2, and dm into the equation of motion in the y direction. Applying Newton's second law in the z direction, dF4 minus dF3 minus dFg equals the mass dm times the acceleration in the z direction, az. Both dF3 and dF4 act at a distance 1/2 dz away from the center. dF3 acts at a point x, y, z plus 1/2 dz, and dF4 acts at a point x, y, z minus 1/2 dz. We can rewrite the pressure force dF3 as the pressure at point x, y, z plus 1/2 dz times the area dx dy. The pressure force dF4 is the pressure at point x, y, z minus 1/2 dz times the area dx dy. The gravitational force is dm times the gravitational acceleration g. And now we substitute in the expressions for dF3, dF4, dFg, and dm into the equation of motion in the z direction. There are three equations of motion that contain six pressures at locations that are very close to a central point x, y, z. We will now express these six pressures as a Taylor series expansion about that central point. Recall that the Taylor series expansion of some arbitrary function f about a point is an infinite series of terms that are calculated from the values of the function's derivatives at that point. For example, a function f evaluated at point x plus dx, yz, is equal to the value of f evaluated at point x, yz, plus partial f partial x evaluated at point x, yz, times dx, plus the second partial derivative of f with respect to x, times dx squared over 2, plus other terms that contain higher order derivatives and dx to higher powers. If dx is very small, as is the case with our fluid element, we can neglect terms that have dx squared and higher because they are relatively very small, and we are left with just the first two terms of the Taylor series expansion. Note that if the positive sign in front of dx on the left side of the equation were changed to a negative sign, the positive sign circled in red on the right side of the equation would change to negative signs as well. For the equation of motion in the x direction, the pressure at x minus half dx is approximately the pressure at x, y, z minus partial p partial x at point x, y, z times dx divided by 2. The pressure at x plus half dx is approximately the pressure at x, y, z plus partial p partial x at point x, y, z times dx divided by 2. Plugging in these expressions into the equation of motion, we see that the pressure at xyz drops out. We can also eliminate dx, dy, dz from both sides of the equation, and we are left with negative partial p partial x evaluated at xyz equals rho times ax. For the equation of motion in the y direction, the pressure at y minus half dy is approximately the pressure at xyz minus partial p partial y at point xyz times dy divided by 2. The pressure at y plus half dy is approximately the pressure at xyz plus partial p partial y at point xyz times dy divided by 2. Plugging in these expressions into the equation of motion, we see that the pressure at xyz drops out, and we can eliminate dx, dy, dz from both sides of the equation. We are left with negative partial p partial y evaluated at xyz equals rho times ay. For the equation of motion in the z direction, the pressure at z minus half dz is approximately the pressure at xyz minus partial p partial z at xyz times dz divided by 2. The pressure at z plus half dz is approximately the pressure at xyz plus partial p partial z at point xyz times dz divided by 2. Plugging in these expressions into the equation of motion, we see that the pressure at xyz drops out, and we can eliminate dx, dy, dz from both sides of the equation. We are left with negative partial p partial z evaluated at xyz minus rho times g equals rho times az. So starting from the three equations of motion, we have obtained three equations that all contain partial derivatives of pressure evaluated at point xyz. For simplicity, the pressure evaluated at xyz will now be denoted by the letter p. We can rewrite these three scalar equations as one vector equation. The sum of the external force vectors acting on the fluid element is equal to the fluid element's mass times the fluid element's acceleration vector. Expanding the vector equation into x, y, and z components, and comparing this equation to the three equations of motion above, we now obtain one equation of motion in vector form. We distribute k-hat to the two terms on the left and bring this equation to the top of the screen. We can write this equation even more compactly by recalling the definition of the gradient of a scalar function. The gradient of some arbitrary scalar function f that is itself a function of x, y, and z is partial f partial x I hat plus partial f partial y j hat plus partial f partial z k hat. We write the gradient of f as del f, where del is the del operator. The equation of motion can be written in vector form as negative gradient p minus gamma k hat equals density times the acceleration vector. This equation is valid for any fluid when shear stresses are negligible. Often the fluid of interest is not accelerating, such as water in a swimming pool. In those situations, we set the acceleration vector to zero. Moving the term gamma k hat to the right side of the equation and equating the x terms, the y terms, and the z terms, we have three equations. Partial p partial x equals zero and partial p partial y equals zero mean that the pressure does not vary in the horizontal direction. Partial p partial z equals negative gamma means the pressure increases as you descend through a fluid, so pressure only varies in the vertical direction. Since pressure is only a function of z, we can rewrite the partial derivatives as full derivatives. dp dz equals negative gamma is called the hydrostatic pressure gradient.